Welcome. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It's so wonderful to see a big crowd here for this very special occasion. My name is Marie Arana, and I'm the curator of this series. I am so grateful to the Kennedy Center for understanding that literature is an art, along with music, dance, and all the rest. And I'm especially grateful to Alicia Adams and to Gilda Almeida, who year after year produce marvelous, marvelous international festivals and stick to their guns in having literature and books be a part of it. So I'm grateful to them. This is Reach to Forest Festival, and the title of the series is Tree Talks. And the first tree talk that we had, which was a few days ago, was called Forest Pharma. It had an ethnobotanist, it had an explorer, it had a mystic, and it had a scholar of forest medicine. This is the second of the series of Tree Talks, and this is called Forests of the Imagination. We have two titans of American literature with us here today. There is one more Tree Talk which I'd like to make sure that you know of. It's on February 28th, and it is at the same time, it's 6 o'clock. It is called Trees and Tech, and it is going to be moderated by the head of the Smithsonian Museum of National Museum of Natural History, Kirk Johnson, and he will have extraordinary scientists who are really working and being quite successful in their work in saving the forests, as best one can when forests are burning and being destroyed, at something that we will learn can be watched from outer space. In any case, I am thrilled to have with us John Williams, who, let me just read a little something about him for you. He oversees books coverage for the Washington Post. And before joining the Post in 2022, he spent 11 years on the book desk of the New York Times, where he edited the paper's staff book critics and frequently wrote literary reviews and features. Before that, John spent 6 years in the editorial department of HarperCollins, and then worked as a freelance writer and editor. He founded the literary website, Second Pass, which featured reviews of new books alongside essays about older and more obscure ones. Today, he runs Bookworld at the Washington Post, as I mentioned, a publication for which I am personally have a great deal of affection, having been a member of its staff many years ago, and a book section that he has single-handedly resuscitated and made into the most vibrant book review machine in the country.
Hi, everybody. Thanks, Marie, for that introduction, which was too kind by at least half. And for asking me to be here tonight. Obviously, I'm thrilled to be on stage with two of the most acclaimed, ambitious, and interesting writers of the past 40 years. I will introduce them very briefly because I think you're all familiar with their work if you're here, and also because properly introducing them and their resumes would take up the allotted 90 minutes. So quickly, Barbara Kingsolver's most recent novel, Demon Copperhead, won the Pulitzer Prize in 2023. It has been on bestseller lists continuously since it was published about a year and a half ago. You might have noticed that it's not out in paperback yet. That's what happens when people just refuse to stop buying the hardcover. That's rare. Kingsolver's many previous novels include, but are not limited to, The Poisonwood Bible, Unsheltered, Flight Behavior, and The Lacuna. She is the only writer to twice win Britain's prestigious Women's Prize for Fiction, previously called the Orange Prize. And she's the recipient of a National Humanities Medal and has written several works of nonfiction and poetry. Richard Powers' most recent novel, Bewilderment, was shortlisted for the Booker Prize and longlisted for the National Book Award. His novel, The Overstory, in which trees memorably play a starring role, won the Pulitzer Prize in 2019. His many other novels include The Echo Maker, winner of the National Book Award, Gain, Orfeo, and the first one that I read many moons ago, Galatea 2.2. He is a recipient of a MacArthur Genius Grant, and a reviewer once wrote, echoing many others, that he has an authoritative grasp of a breathtaking range of subjects. Please join me in welcoming them. So we're here as part of Reach to Forest, and obviously that applies to you both in very clear ways, which we'll get to, and we'll stay close to the themes of nature and science as we talk. But I want to start, before we get to the books and your lives as writers, with nature away from work. I was hoping that each of you could share a formative memory of some profound experience you had with nature, whether you could articulate at the time or maybe even still what exactly it touched in you.
I was born on the north side of Chicago, so you may immediately think no nature for this boy, but you'd be wrong. And in fact, you'd be applying a very adult sensitivity to the question of what nature is. You know, there's a great line by Goethe. I hate to start out by quoting.
Nowhere to go but down.
That's right. That's right. No, he says, it's just such an amazing line. He says, thinking is better than knowing, but it's not as good as looking. And when you're a child, you don't know anything. And you're just starting to assemble the apparatus of complex thought. But everything is looking. Everything is looking. And in this little suburban house on the north side of Chicago, you know, I made the classic adult move, going back in my 30s and looking at this place and thinking, we seven people lived in that house? And the backyard is like a poster. No, when I was a kid, I couldn't see the end of it. And there were more forms of life in that little patch of suburban backyard than I've ever been aware of until fairly recently, in terms of, you know, life per square foot. And every day was an adventure, mostly invertebrates, but, you know, for a kid, you know, the smaller and the stranger, the better. And, you know, I was the B-boy of the north side of Chicago. And this wasn't all that long. I was born in 57, so this wasn't all that long after Frisch had discovered the waggle dance. And I remember reading about that as a kid, and I learned how to decode the waggle dance. And, you know, my teacher at school would say, Ricky, you handle the lesson today. You know, and I would teach all the kids about how the bees communicate with each other. But the
which made you so popular.
Yeah, they loved that. Love that. But I would also. My popularity doesn't need
I'm
to be.
I'm just saying, I was there too. We become novelists because, you know, we were unpopular kids. Sorry, go ahead.
So, just endless adventures. And a stray cat under somebody's back porch that we couldn't quite get to and had to lure out. I mean, that was an adventure. But also bringing home this strange white silky thing that, you know, had a perfect oval shape to it, you know, and putting it in a little cardboard box and waking up the next morning and there's a polyphemus moth flying around the house, you know, that's something, you know. And that was my life until 11, at which point I moved to Bangkok, Thailand, and suddenly all the flora, all the fauna, and the relationship between people and non-people was changed. And that's something we have in common too.
Besides being nerds that had to teach the third grade. Very similar story. I grew up, well, not in a suburb or outside of a city. I grew up in really one of the more rural parts of the country, Eastern Kentucky, a really extremely rural childhood. We lived out in the on a farm, among farms, too far to walk to town or any other form of commerce, or even, you know, a friend's house or anything. Like, Halloween for us was like a marathon. We probably walked 26 miles to get to like eight doors, but, you know, candy. So my siblings and I were just wild kids. We played in the alfalfa fields. We played in the woods. We fished in the farm ponds. When I look back on my childhood, really, you know, kind of when I drift my memories over the whole of my childhood, I see virtually no adult supervision, which is really so wonderful. Honestly, a resource that I think is pretty precious and kids might not get enough of anymore. Just the fact that we were left our own devices, and sometimes heavy on the vices, because we were just so curious, and we caught any animal we could. We caught snakes and kept them. My mother had a rule, two things couldn't come in the house, snakes or mice. So we did smuggle them in some. But we caught a little snapping turtle. Snapping turtles, you know how hideous, scary they are. But when they're really little, they're so cute. And so we caught a little snapping turtle and named him George. My brother and I put him in a pickle jar. And he grew, and he grew. And
took your finger off one day.
We would just, you know, drop in, you know, raw hamburger. But when you put your finger up to the jar, he'd go, ah! You know, like, not cute. And then he got so... I have remorse for this. I'm sorry. We kept him so long that he was too big to get out of the jar. We had to break the pickle jar to get him out. But he's fine. I'm sure his progeny are out there still talking about Uncle George. But that was just, I mean, we just had so much curiosity and an endless playground. And it was, you know, you might look at this childhood as one of deprivation, but it was so great for us. We had the bookmobile, we had books, we had the library at school, and we had the wilderness. And I think what that meant for me is I grew up, because I was not surrounded by things made by people, I grew up with a confirmed sense of myself as not the center of the universe, of an animal among animals, a species among species that are all really important and connected, and every one of them actually thinks it's the center of the world. You know, when the cardinal is singing from the tree, he's saying, I'm all that,
right.
And he doesn't care about us.
I don't think it's romanticizing at all to say that inside every little kid is an empirical scientist, mm-hmm. and an animist, mm-hmm. right? Who's seeing in a kind of imminent way, you know, God in everything, and a kind of kinship that we lose track of as we get older. But you also had this experience of when you were seven, going from one specific
wild, unsupervised childhood to another. Yeah, our family moved to extremely rural Congo, which put rural in a whole new light, because in this village there was no electricity, no running water, no commerce, no cars, no roads. It was a village where everything people had, they made themselves. And so, and I tried to make friends with Congolese kids and felt so... what's the word? Incompetent, because I was seven, and most 7 and 8 year olds were either taking care of their younger sibs if they were girls, or if they were boys, they were getting food for the family. And so I learned to tried to keep up with the other village kids. Our only potential playmates were Congolese kids. There was no school, so this is what I always say I did instead of second grade. Went to the Congo. And, you know, just again, just, I mean, my poor mother was probably just trying to figure out what to feed us. But, you know, I remember working so hard to climb a tree to keep up with this little friend of mine, and he found a bird nest, and I was so excited, a bird nest, and he pulls out a baby bird, you know, the little pink baby bird, and he says, did I want it for a pet, pickle jar, what? And I said, no. He said, okay. Wow. And so I was introduced to another, as you say, another relationship between people and other species that's just much more interdependent, and realizing, well, yeah, you know what? We all eat animals. We all eat something else that was alive. We just don't generally have to pluck it out of its nest.
Hmm. I'm glad you brought up the Congo, because I'm going to start with a kind of explicitly forest-based question for each of you, because I feel like that'll fulfill my contract, and then we'll... And then we'll range more widely, because having your brains on stage, I would have to take advantage of that. So I'm going to start with Barbara. The one of my favorite opening paragraphs, I think, in any novel is the first full paragraph in the Poisonwood Bible. So I'm going to read that, and I'm going to tell you before I do, so you can think about this. I know how careful you are in terms of the decisions you make when you're constructing your book. So I want you to talk about the decision to start the book this way. There's one short sentence that precedes this, but the decision to start the book this way and what you remember about starting it this way and how you sort of conjured this image. First, picture the forest. I want you to be its conscience, the eyes and the trees. The trees are columns of slick, brindled bark like muscular animals overgrown beyond all reason. Every space is filled with life. Delicate, poisonous frogs, war-painted like skeletons, clutched in copulation, secreting their precious eggs onto dripping leaves. Vines strangling their own kin in the everlasting wrestle for sunlight. The breathing of monkeys. A glide of snake belly on branch. A single-file army of ants biting a mammoth tree into uniform grains and hauling it down to the dark for their ravenous queen. And in reply, a choir of seedlings arching their necks out of rotted tree stumps, sucking life out of death. This forest eats itself and lives forever.
Oh, that's an opening.
That's an opening.
Thank you.
And
what was the question?
The question is, take me back to beginning the book that way. I know that you're very intentional about the choices you make. So beginning the book with those images and how long you spent in the Congo as a child, how you sort of got back to conjuring that image and that space as an adult writing the Poisonwood Bible?
Well, that's another whole question, because it took years and years to research. You know, when I was a kid, I wasn't paying attention to the political situation or even like exactly what my mother had to go through every day to feed us. So there was a lot of research that stood between me and writing that novel. But that paragraph was written long, long before I really had enough material to write the rest of the novel. I always knew I would start there. I am really intentional, I suppose most novelists are, but about the beginning, it's really important. More important now than ever, because you have the opportunity to read the first 30 pages before you hit buy book. Pressure is on. But I believe that a first paragraph should make a promise to the reader that the rest of the book will keep. And I really think a lot and revise that first paragraph to contain that promise. And what is the promise here? Yeah, interesting that it's a forest that eats itself and lives forever. I wanted to write a novel about imperial arrogance, about what one nation will do to another, what one mentality of superiority will impose upon another in the guise of help or charity or even more unkind motives. And it always seemed to me, undoubtedly because I grew up among the snapping turtles and leaves, that so much of the Western approach to the world is kind of banking on this biblical mandate to go forth and use and multiply and like make this garden your own. You own this garden. And that has just gotten us into all kinds of trouble. And I think that one of the things I really probably absorbed living in the Congo is these were people who did not think they owned nature. Nature kind of owned them. It was at best a relationship, you know, not one of ownership. So that really felt to me like the starting point for this grand tale about people, but also about cultural arrogance
and exceptionalism. Yeah. In a way that's the way that book tackles this notion of Western exceptionalism as a cultural phenomenon, and humans adopting this perspective of human exceptionalism in the interdependent web of living things, we're separate from that, we're above it,
its laws don't apply to us.
Well, speaking of which, Richard, this is from deep in the overstory, page 375 in my edition, this paragraph. 20 springs is no time at all. The hottest year ever measured comes and goes, then another, then 10 more, almost every one of them among the hottest in recorded history. The seas rise, the year's clock breaks. 20 springs and the last one starts 2 weeks earlier than the first. Species disappear. Patricia writes of them, too many species to count. Reefs bleach and wetlands dry. Things are going lost that have not yet been found. Kinds of life vanish 1,000 times faster than the baseline extinction rate. Forest larger than most countries turns to farmland. Look at the life around you. Now delete half of what you see. So many great lines in that. But the first one about 20 springs being no time at all, this is something you often do in the book, contrasting how humans think of time and how time exists outside of us, before us, without us. That character, Patricia, who's a very central character in the book, at one point thinks this is not our world with trees in it. It's a world of trees where humans have just arrived. Talk about that contrast and how it felt thinking about that so much while you were writing the book. I'm sure it changed your everyday perspective. I picture you getting the wrong meal at a restaurant and just thinking, well, what's the big deal? It's 200 million years, that's not that big a problem.
Yeah. Well, it was depressing listening to that passage and thinking of how many seasons since I wrote that have passed and how much truer all those observations are now, you know, 8 more seasons down the line. But so much of that book has to do with challenging the notion of an exceptionalism, but also challenging the notion of understanding the world on a human time scale, or even a cultural time scale. And you can do this at a lot of levels. It was brought to me when I was living in Silicon Valley in the early 2010s. And you know, I would go to dinner, and one or another, you know, techno bro at dinner would say, just hold on a little bit longer, stay healthy, ride your bike, you know, if you can hold out just a little bit longer, we're gonna defeat death. You know, there's this design flaw in humans, and you know, we're gonna take care of that. And how do I live in this place? And you know, to get away, I would go up into the Santa Cruz Mountains, you know, just between Silicon Valley and the oceans, this stretch of coastal mountain that is now filled with regenerating redwoods. And to see what a redwood can do in 100 years, you know, which is a time frame that we understand, and to stand in front of a redwood that's 100 years old and to be, you know, gobsmacked by it and humbled by it because of the scale that it's achieved, and knowing that this is an ecosystem of thousands of interdependent species, you know, that have come back from a very drastic human exploitation. And I was up there walking in these recovering redwood forests one day when I came across an escapee, you know, a tree that had somehow managed to not be harvested when the rest of that coastal range was taken in order to build San Francisco and to build the valley and to build the railroads. And to stand in front of a tree that's 1,500 years old, you know, older than Charlemagne, and you know, half the width of this room, and you know, a football field tall, is suddenly to be cast onto an entirely different scale of time and enterprise than the individual. This is an individual organism. And I began to read, and it happened to me again as I was doing, you know, further research into the coming and going of these populations of trees. And, you know, the ultimate realization that the, you know, that trees came up onto the land almost as soon as life did, as multicellular life did, 400 million years or more, and that we've been working our pyramid scheme for 100,000 years or on that order, right? So if you're talking about, you know, any kind of, you know, accurate appraisal of who's doing what in this world, you know, and not only does that mean they've been around 2,000 times longer than we have, but everything that we've done has been contingent upon their prior existence. And, you know, the exceptionalist point of view is we did this, we took dominion over the earth and we subdued it, you know, and we did that on our own through our you know, really unique powers. No, we did it because we spent the capital that 400 million years had been accumulating.
And is still working for us. Okay, like, okay, take a breath. Take a deep breath. A tree made that for you. Right now, just a little while ago, the trees are making oxygen for us to breathe. It's amazing that we can go through our whole lives forgetting we need those leaves to breathe.
You two are both are closer to science than the average novelist, both in terms of your concerns and what you write about, but also the fact that you both studied it as students. And I'm going to veer briefly, since it's still early in the program, into pessimism so that we'll dig our way out of it by the time we're done.
Well, so early in the night.
It's early in the night, and you were on the road all day, and I'm sorry.
But as Demon would say, we'd like to believe that the story isn't over until the last page, right?
yes. This isn't the last page. But it did occur to me in preparing for this that, you know, Barbara, you studied evolutionary biology, and obviously, Richard, you're talking about these things that I think it's safe to say that it's hard to motivate people to really appreciate. They can appreciate it, but to motivate them to act based on some of the crises that we're facing. And there are all kinds of theories about this, even well-intentioned people, the kind of slow motion unfolding of environmental crises and how we're not really wired to think that way. And given how hard it is to convince each other about the importance of the very environment that makes our existence possible and how relatively briefly we've been here, it almost seems to me like you could make an argument that there's some kind of evolutionary mistake in us, that we have all these powers you talked about, and you're both sterling examples of those powers, and yet, for all we can create and imagine and think, we are harming ourselves in these ways. Where do you find the hope to kind of convince people or to band together with people and change things?
You want to take a stab, Bird?
Sure. Yeah, that's an interesting, and of course, not an entirely novel thought that we are a big mistake and we're doing a good job of erasing ourselves. But I don't think of us that way. I do remember that cardinal in the tree saying, I'm all that, I'm all that, I'm all that, is, you know, has the same flaw that we all have. We all think we are the center of the universe. And we have, in addition to that, the capacity for empathy for one another and also for other species. And we have the chance to do something with that. I take hope from a lot of places, but I take it especially from kids. Children are, I agree with you, Rick, that children are all, they're sort of born naturalists. I think that this is, there's a lot in our wiring, in our evolutionary sort of makeup that kicks in at various ages that makes us, you know, right about the age that kids wean. You know, if you think back when, you know, we were living on the savannah or wherever we were living, kids wean and get put down on the ground and start learning how to distinguish between this and that. Right around 3 and 4, they get to be very picky eaters. Do you know why? Because if they ate the poison berry, they would die. So it's a very natural thing for them to be very particular and to not want to eat something if it strikes them the wrong way. And the, another thing is like around 4 or 5, you see the I think it's normal for kids to start learning to sort this from that. And in modern times, it goes into Pokemon, right? Right? Or so like these different things, or My Little Pony, or these things that are manufactured that have a whole lot of categories, and kids sort that, they collect and sort them. That's just not, I mean, put them outside and they would be learning, they would be learning botany, they would be learning, you know, plant taxonomy, and they would learn, be learning how to tell one salamander from another. It's just wired in us. And I do believe in getting kids outside. And what I see is, you know, a lot of a return to this. A lot of parents understand the importance of getting their kids outside. I think that we only work to save what we love, and you can only love what you know. So I think a lot more people, a lot more families go outdoors than they did when, I mean, when I was little, camping was a very weird thing to do. Now it's a really pretty normal thing to do, and that makes me happy.
So there are two really interesting parts of your question. I mean, one is, are we a mistake? And the other is, where do you find hope? And on the, are we a mistake? I mean, it's, if you can really cultivate this sense of long time and of interdependence, then you realize that that's not a vocabulary that you can apply to species. I mean, species are part of an endlessly ramifying, revising, self-revising experiment. And 99% of all species that ever existed have gone extinct. And you know, the first part of escaping climate anxiety is to really take seriously this idea that we have been through mass extinction events. We, meaning I, my bees, Barbara's salamanders, right? We have been through a mass extinction many, many times. And some many, many branches of the endlessly ramifying experiment carry on and start speculating again. We have been a tremendously successful species, and all our assets are in place for, you know, the leveraging the massive changes that we brought upon ourselves and, you know, finding ways forward. Now, that doesn't mean, when you say, where do you find hope? The first question is, hope for what, right? And a lot of times when people ask me that, I realize that what they mean is, are we, contemporary Americans, going to get over the finish line with all our stuff? And the answer is no. Stop hoping for that, right? And start hoping for a change that re-enters this experiment and re-accepts the interdependence that's needed in order to be a continuing member of that endlessly ramifying community of experiments. Now, you know, once you settle into that, then you can take daily pleasure again and start to learn to love where you are and what's what the ground beneath your feet wants to do. All those abilities that we have to collect and categorize become joys again instead of panic, anxiety. And you can begin to say, whatever happens, the experiment goes on in many, many different ways, will we be there? Not in this form, right? But that's okay, because the form that we're in right now is not a successful experiment. It's not a speculation that's working out, right? So that, do I think that culture can change rapidly? Absolutely. I mean, if again, to go back to this time frame thing, if evolution, if the frame of the base frame of evolution is in the millions of years, the base frame of culture is in centuries, right? Base frame of digital culture is tens of years. The base frame of AI is months, apparently, right now, right? But the point is, this massive alienation that we're talking about is a very, very recent phenomenon. Throughout most of human history, in most places of the world, the stories would always have had trees and salamanders and bees in them. And isn't it amazing that 10 years ago, when I started thinking about these things and I started to work on our story, almost all our stories, meaning contemporary American literature, had stripped out the non-human world from it entirely. But look what's happening. In a very short period of time, there's been this explosion of realization that we need to tell new kinds of stories. So culture can move fast, right? It won't move fast enough to allow us to keep all our things over the finish line. That's just not possible. But it will. It is very possible, very conceivable to me, that it'll move fast enough to allow us to continue the experiment in some way.
Yeah, it can move fast enough. We can move quickly toward finding the grace to learn to appreciate what we have rather than devoting our lives to grasping what we don't, reaching for what we don't have.
Isn't that right? I mean, the great crisis now is not how can I save the world from climate change so that my culture can continue in its current form. The real crisis now for everybody is having built a culture of individualist, commodity-mediated appetite, how can I help build a culture where meaning isn't that? Where meaning is out there. It's not about wanting more. It's about knowing the infinite that's already here. You know, and I go back to childhood and I think of that yard, which was nothing but everything, because I was there attending to it all the time. You know how when you've got the photo up on your phone and you go like this, right? That's what learning presence and learning attention does. It makes it there's an infinite zoom that you can put on the world, and it solves the great crisis, which is our appetite is killing us, but we will always be universally curious. Well, if we just you know, to go back to quote, thinking is better than knowing, but it's not as good as looking. Wanting is better than having, but it's not as good as attending, right? Or waiting, just being present.
See, you're both welcome, because that was called playing the foil. I knew that my sullen dorm room question would lead to your cautiously optimistic profundity. And so that's an assist for me. But the points are all yours. I want to zoom out a bit now. Speaking of infinite zoom, would be a good title for something. To zoom out to your lives as writers and thinkers. Barbara, a review once said that you take risks that other contemporary novelists wouldn't dare, and it's something that's been said about both of you in various ways throughout your careers, I think. And what I'm curious about is whether ideas feel risky to you when you set out to write them, and how much risk you're willing to accept when something is going to take so much time, thought, and energy when you're embarking on a long project.
And trees. Don't forget the trees that are going to be pulped to make these books.
Seriously, good
I mean,
point.
That's part of it, yeah. too. But anyway, so
resources.
I just had to give the trees their due. Yes, I'll say, heck yes, it feels risky in the moment. Because I mean, it's not to take this lightly. I was raised polite. I'm a Southern girl. And when I think about what I'm saying to you, put down your life. Listen to me for 10 to 12 hours. That's a huge ask. Actually, the audiobook of Demon was like 30 hours. I'm sorry. But I'm aware of what I'm asking of you as a reader. And I enter the project with so much awareness of the fact that I'm bothering you. I'm asking you to pay attention to something. So it has to be so important. It has to be something that's keeping me awake at night and that I suspect is probably keeping you awake at night. And maybe we can have this conversation that will get us somewhere where maybe afterwards we could go to sleep. it's not necessarily going to answer a big question, but at least engage you to think about something really important. So, yeah, that has to be a big canvas. It has to be a big question. And everyone has to be brand new. I always want to write a book that I've never written before. And ideally that nobody's ever written before. So, you know, you map it all out. You get your legal pads and you draw the architecture of this novel. You figure out who's going to be in it. And then you start writing it. And I always think every time, I mean, 17 books in, 18, whatever it is, every time I think this one's going to suck. I am going to blow this. This is going to be a mess. But the good thing is nobody's going to know because the door to my office is, we work in private. Nobody's going to see it until I've revised it 700 times and made it worthy. And then it gets to go out the door into the room. But it's a really scary, I mean, I feel like, if I'm not anxious, if I'm not nervous that this craft is gonna crash and burn at any moment, I'm not working at the edge of my powers. So yes, I'm not a risk taker in my, you know. Well, we just drove all day long in our electric car, and every time it got down to 20%, I was like, find a charge station. I'm not one of those, let's run it down to 2%.
That was my job.
Yeah. Come on, we can get to what was it, Stanton. So no, I'm not a risk taker in life. I don't rock climb, but parachute, that's the idea of jumping out of an airplane, no way. But at my desk, I jump out of that airplane every day because that's what makes it the best you can do.
I was going to say the downside to that process, that mental state where you say, I always thought of it as mountain climbing, you know, where the first draft is like a piton in the rock, and you can't fall any farther than where you are, so that gives you the freedom to kind of reach up for a higher. Well, the downside to that sense of perpetual risk is I've been at the podium with the finished book, you know, it's a year after publication, I'm reading the chapter, and give me a red pen, yeah, I got to fix this.
Factory recall, bring them all back. I can fix this, I can make this better. It is, it's really hard to know when a book is finished because every pass makes it a little better. That's the hard, how do you know when you're done?
The publisher stands on my front door and says.
Yeah, it's time, yeah, me too. It's time.
I feel like you're both at a point where you could ask, you know, you could say, get away from my door for a few more weeks. So how...
we do.
Yeah, you do. Yeah. All right. So we won't ask how you really know when it's finished. You just trust. What is the... have either of you ever had an idea that it makes... The way that both of you just described that, it makes it sound as if once you have the idea, no matter how steep the mountain is, just through grit and sweat, you're going to make it work. But have you ever had an idea where you got maybe a couple of weeks into drafting and you just thought, this is too much, I can't do this?
That's what short stories are for.
Okay. Is it?
Short stories are, I mean, I love having so many different, you know, writing poetry, writing short stories, nonfiction, fiction. I think of them as all different vehicles, and every idea has an ideal vehicle. You know, it might, like a poem is like a unicycle. You know, it's just like you can carry one small thing and it's all about the balance. A novel is like a station wagon. You just keep throwing stuff in back. You don't have room for one more. But it is, once you get into a novel and you have decided you're not, well, and also, I also think like writing short stories is like dating, you know, you can try it out.
Swipe left,
swipe right. Yeah. And there is something about writing a novel that is like a marriage. It's like, we're in here. I don't love you today, but I will love you tomorrow, and somehow we'll get there. You know, we'll all go through therapy. I adore my husband, but you know what I'm talking about, right? It's the long haul. It takes years. But that's why I also spend a couple of years deciding to commit. No short engagements for me. I have to know for sure I'm going to do this before
I get in. Is research part of that, or is it more just, you know, more the plot and the idea of what you're going to do as a novelist? Or do you look into, because I imagine both of you do. Have you ever written a novel that didn't involve research of some sort?
Is that a thing?
I think it is, yeah, but not for you.
I love this line by Percival Everett. He says, I write these books to learn things, you know?
Hmm. Yeah, I agree with that, and I love it. And and that's kind of it's the kind of hairpin I am. When I was in college, I wanted to major in everything. Wow, anthropology, this is so cool.
That's how we got away with it. We found this career where you don't have to make a decision.
Exactly, you get to major in everything, and it's so fun. I have thought that, a novel is about like a dissertation. It takes about that long. You have to do about that much research. You have to become at least enough of an expert to either answer all the questions of your committee or give it to the readers and let them occasionally write to you and say, you got this one little thing wrong, but mostly not. Yeah, it's a big project, and you learn so much, and you get to be you get to enter a world of people who know, you have to know so much about professions. Hmm. Like everybody in your novel has a job, or else they don't, but you know, that's a thing too. So you have to know, you have to be the smartest person in your novel. You can't say, well, then the astrophysicist said something very clever. You have to know what that was, and you have to write that in between quotes, and it has to make sense. So, but that's the fun of it. Mm. That's so enjoyable. And then you're done, and you want to leave that subject and move to another subject. We've been talking about this. And every journalist in the country calls to ask you their question about trees or about Indian child welfare, whatever it was your last book was about.
We're going to get to questions from the crowd with plenty of time to spare, so think about what you might want to ask Barbara and or Richard. Richard, you mentioned AI just a little while ago in the window of months, that it's doubling and tripling what we know. And I was thinking about how relevant, again, maybe even more so, Galatea 2.2 is these days. But where it led me as I thought about it was that you had, and still have, obviously great interest in sort of technological frontiers of human development and how we use them and interact with them. But it strikes me that it's kind of funny. You wrote the overstory at this point in your life and your career, where it's almost like it's almost a mirror for me of the environmental crisis, which is that we had spent so many decades of kind of feeling like everything was flush, and all we have to do is beat death, invent artificial brains, all this wild stuff that we probably will do, you know, I hope we don't beat death. But you kind of reached outside of that world to write about this much more. It's almost like you were going back in time in a way. Does that ring true at all?
It was absolutely like going back through time, because that kid in Lincolnwood on the north side of Chicago, you know, my parents planted trees when we were born. So there was a maple out in the backyard that was me, and that was a very mysterious thing. You know, and to go back and see that tree later in life, and you know, we're the same age, and that boy was intimately connected with the plants in the backyard. But as I grew and aged, I fell out of that. And the overstory was this late life moment where it's like, come back, you know. And for me, it was a deeply recreational book because it was a deeply recreational book. It was going back and becoming that child again and collecting them all, you know, and starting to realize that I had moved through my life where I was passing by the essentials as if they were the incidentals. And it was that recovering of the astonishing particularity and ingenuity and endless fecundity that for me was just had just been instrumentalized, you know, to come back to that the way a child comes back to it. Was why I'll always think of that book as, you know, the before and after moment of my late life.
I don't like hearing you say late life.
Yeah, I was going to say midlife.
There's a person in Silicon Valley who's going to make this life.
You're 2 years younger than me.
We'll reconvene when you've each published your 300th novel 250 years from now. Barbara, I have to ask, before we go to the crowd, I have to ask you a question about Demon Copperhead, because it's been such a runaway success, and also because the social context of that novel is obviously the opioid crisis, as everyone well knows at this point. I think that human crises are probably more related than we like to imagine they are, but you've talked about the importance of being kind of nimble in figuring out what the next idea is and not being afraid to move on from what you just did and find the new thing. And so I'm curious about what it was about that context that moved you to write the book. It's such a, social novels, you both avoid this trap somehow, but a lot of social novels are kind of dead on arrival, and they have this kind of, they have the profundity or the faux profundity, but the voice in that book is so outrageously funny from the first page, in addition to heartbreaking. So the character, I get why once the voice was in your head, it was kind of irresistible, but what was the larger idea behind the context of the book and what you wanted to set it against?
That book is about my place where I live and my people, to whom I belong, who are have been treated as an internal colony in this country for 200 years. And we Appalachians don't see ourselves on TV, in movies, in the news. It's larger than that. There's a divide between rural and urban people in this country, a terribly dangerous political divide. We're not speaking to each other. We're not talking across that divide. I wanted to try to do that. I wanted to try to put my place and my people on the map. And I think an important and the opioid crisis was just kind of the entry, because that's the latest in a sort of the train of exploitations that have been imposed on Appalachia. First they came and took the timber, then they came and took the coal, and leaving a mess behind, leaving in every way limiting the opportunities of the people who live there in order to keep a sort of a captive labor force. And finally they came to harvest our pain and make a fortune. So with that historical context, I wanted to write about this division between rural and urban people, and the frustration of half of us in this country who don't live in cities, who feel overlooked at best, mocked at worst, because all of the media, all of the, you know, the arts, the news, the entertainment, it's all made in cities by city people, and through no fault of their own, they just don't know us. They don't know who we are. And an important part about that is that we're connected to the land. That's what, I mean, we, whether we're farmers or miners or what, the land, we're land people, and our attachment to the land is what is, really is what's looked down on. That's the source of contempt. And it's, this is actually Demon and his friend Tommy, when they're kind of figuring this out, it dawns on them in the cartoon hillbilly has a straw hat, a fishing pole, and the XXX moonshine jug. That's all about self-sufficiency. It's about being a farmer, I mean, catching fish, making your own entertainment. This is the age-old sort of very, very sort of long-term global, what word should I use? Sort of hoodwink. You know, to suggest that people who are still attached to the land are living a provisional existence because they haven't yet moved to the city and learned what real life is. And I can't overestimate how present that is in our lives as land people. We hear our city friends say, how can you live out there in the middle of nowhere? It's my everywhere. It's got water coming out of the mountain into my house. That's where our house, our water comes out of the mountain. And we have a garden and we grow food. So this divide between land people and money people.
And unlanded people.
Unlanded people.
I prefer city folk.
You know, it's about monetizing your labor. Mm-hmm. And so when you move people to the city, you can monetize their labor and you can pay tax, you know, then they have to pay taxes. It's just as really, that's what it boils down to. So ultimately, this, again, is a book written by the little girl playing in the woods. All of Demon's moments of peace and happiness in that book, almost all of them happen when he's outside.
Can I just add, John, I mean, for me, what puts Barbara at the very center and summit of contemporary American literature is that from Bean Trees to Demon, she has explored all the essential social crises and conflicts of our time, but it's constantly through that lens of knowing that a person is a person by virtue of where they are, because where they are wants to do things. That place is alive. Mm-hmm. It's not an exploitable, extractable resource. Mm-hmm. It's a living thing with affordances. And to know who you are and how and to understand your desires requires seeing you as part of that place. So they are absolutely social novels, but every one of them is also an environmental novel. And there's so much life in Demon beyond the social crisis. You know, the amount of knowledge of that place and what that place is doing, you know, prior to humans and despite humans is part of what makes it so beautiful.
Well, thank you.
Well, I did have it in my holster to ask you to say one thing you envy about the other. I'll let that stand in for her ability to write about social subjects in such a readable, entertaining way.
Well, you know, I didn't always love Barbara. I started out insanely jealous of Barbara because she was my mother's absolute all-time favorite writer. And you know, my mother would say, have you read the new Kingsolver? It's fabulous. And I would say, Mom, what about my emotional needs? But, you know, I think Prodigal Summer was the first that I read. And, you know, not to give anything away, but that the last chapter that shifts into the non-human world, and, I mean, I'm choking up just remembering it, you know, and understanding that message was so eye-opening to me. It really was an essential part of my education for working my way back to Overstory.
Wow. Well.
Well, thank you.
We'll show Richard some love.
Well, okay. Well.
What about his emotional needs?
My mother never read you. So I have loved you from the beginning. I can't say that word envy because that suggests that I want to take something of yours and make it mine, and that just, it doesn't work that way. I want I want Richard Powers to keep writing those books. So you're not late in life, just so you know. But I would say the same thing. What moves me the most, well, I love and admire the size of your canvases, the ambition. I hate that word ambitious, mainly because it's used as a weapon against women, but it's okay to say a man is ambitious. As Robert Burns would say, that your reach exceeds your grasp every time in a new, completely new world, and that you hold these big, huge ideas in complete balance while you work through the characters and the plot. It's just exquisite to read and to watch. And finally, the Overstory is just going to be my favorite novel till I die. It's that simple. It's interesting that we're saying the same thing about each other. The way that by the end of that novel, I felt that I had inhabited the sentience of trees, that I was seeing the world from the point of view of a tree, was a perfect religious experience for me, because I've always, since I was little, I've always believed that God lived in trees. I mean, when I was small, I actually thought, like, people talked about God and I knew he was like up there in the trees. And then it became a little more abstract, but my religion never moved very far from that kind of animism, that belief that trees hold infinity and can give us the peace of knowing we're not really all that. So thank you.
You know, you use the R word, and it has come up a lot for me, much more than in my earlier books when people want to talk about, you know, are these recent books religious books? And if you think about that word etymologically, it's religio, it's religare, to tie back together. And I just think that's the common thread of our fictional pursuit, is to try to tie people back together to the rest of the living world.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah, you're both pretty good. And on that note, I know that their fans are rabid and curious. So if anyone has a question, I'll point to people and try to shout.
Can you work on more than one writing project at a time? And if so, how?
Do you work on more than one writing project at a time? And if so, how?
I can't really. I mean, I can stop briefly the novel in order to write a shorter piece, but usually if it's a nonfiction piece or an occasional piece, I don't like to do it. I just want to be in that novel, you know. So I've never really tried to keep more than one project going at once.
Yeah, I'm the same. I'd say I'm serially monogamous. However, there's a rhythm. There's a couple of years where I feel like I'm cooking a novel on the back burner. I'm not ready to move it frontwards and really work on it every day. It just needs to cook. And during that period, I'm always really happy to take on shorter projects. You always get asked, right? They're always saying, well, would you write an article about this or that or the other? And some of the invitations are very interesting, or you have an idea for an essay or some shorter piece or piece of journalism you'd like to do. I save those up, and I try to do them after I've finished a novel, while I'm in that in that cooking period, because once that novel gets up to the upfront boiling, I just want to go in there. And it's hard to describe how compelling it is to be in there. It's hard to come out. You know, people ask, I don't know about you, people ask, well, what do you do to get in the mood to write? Wake up? I mean, I do not want to vacuum. I do not want to go do the dishes. I wake up with the words just pooling in my head, and I can't. I go straight to the coffee maker, get my cup of coffee, go straight to my desk. And then I could be, and this is could be like at 5 in the morning, and I could be in there until maybe like 3 or 4 in the afternoon, and all of a sudden I kind of snap out of it and say, I have a body, and all of it hurts. So that's not, you know, then you get up and you stretch a little bit and stuff. But I'm thankful, frankly, to my family who have, over the years, required me to get away from my desk and do other things, because otherwise I think that you would have found my skeleton, you know, just like... But, draped over
but
the
also
keyboard.
Who take up the slack and do a lot of the things
yes.
that we should be doing.
Yes.
Gotta give credit there.
Absolutely. Yeah. But when the kids were little, you know, it was just, that was the hardest part, to just pull out of that world and go, you know, go pick them up at school or whatever. And sometimes I would just think, oh, God, please don't let me put the baby in the oven instead of the lasagna, because you just, it's so, you're so pulled. You've created a whole world and you live in there and people talk to you. And I know they give people drugs for that, but it's just what we, you know, we need the money, right?
Sir, and then. What has changed or grown or improved that you're doing now from your earlier novels? And this is tougher, I think. Casting forward, what might you be doing? What powers may you not have unleashed yet, if you're...
It's funny. I hope it's okay to... You know, we were corresponding not too long ago, and I was saying, you know, I'm 66. I'm going to turn 67 in June. And I feel like I'm finally learning how to drive this thing, you know? And... I remember when I was in college and thinking, you know, what career do I? I'm good at math. I'm good at, you know, science, and I'm thinking, boy, if I go into math, I'm going to peak at 25. You know, and you know, it's a lot of the sciences are like that too. It's like you do your great work when you're young, and I just thought, you know, this writing thing can go on and on and on, and if I were to characterize what I'm learning to be a little bit less of that third grade nerd and a little bit more attuned to what other people think of as heat.
As what?
As heat.
Heat.
You know, and allowing myself to give more time and attention to these strange passions that we show toward each other. In our need and in our fear, you know. So I think the books have become more human in that way. And you know, the point that I feel is, you know, there aren't a lot of years left, and I feel more robust than I have. So why do I have to go on book tour? You know?
Why are we even here? We should be home writing right now. I agree completely. I feel so lucky to be a novelist, not an athlete, not a model, not an actor, not, I mean, whose careers... you know, really peak at 30. We're in the wisdom trade, I think. What people go, I believe people go to fiction, yes, for entertainment, but really for wisdom, to kind of figure out how they fit into the world. And wisdom, it's like scar tissue. You only get it by living and making mistakes and getting hurt and figuring out what went wrong, how did that happen, how can it do better, how can we do better. You just accrue it by staying alive. The only advice I've ever been able to give young writers is stop smoking. Because your best shot at greatness is to live a long time. Keep writing, and another thing besides just getting old and, you know, gray and, you know, with some putative wisdom, is that you have been by now many other people, many other writers, and you still contain them all. I've heard a lot since the publication of Demon Copperhead, not necessarily directly to me, but like chatter on Book Talk or Instagram. Have you seen her picture? She's old. She's like got gray hair. How does she know what teenagers are like? I mean, you know, said with all due respect, of course. I was a teenager. I remember it so well. I remember being 13 way better than I remember being, you know, 40. Everything was so new and intense and you know, the longing, the lust, the, you know, all of those things I remember so well. And I also remember, you know, being a young mother and all of these things that we've been through, we still have them. So it's really just getting to be alive this long that I think is the bonus.
I'd also like to think that the stories are getting more humble. And I know that in outside the writing, that value has become massively more important to me, just humility. And I'll do the etymology thing again. That means closer to the humus.
Right. Yeah, and compassion. I think when I was 20, I knew absolutely everything. And mostly that so many people were wrong. And boy, did that change. You know, with the passing decades, I have come to understand that really everybody's right. Or at least they think they are, and they have good reason.
There's a context and a situation for which you can see that as the
right. Exactly, that way. I'm the one who listens to every side of the argument and says, yeah, yes, and yes, and yes. And that's crucial in writing a novel, because you have to be able to get inside the soul and the will, and the hopes and the fears of every single one of your characters, even the so-called bad ones, even the villains. You have to be able to get inside there and see the world, see through eyes, you know, and a brain that really believes this is the best course of action. If you can't do that, if you can't get inside of all the sides of your argument, those characters will be cardboard. They won't feel real.
You had your hand up a minute ago. Still have a question.
So you are both recipients of the F. Scott Fitzgerald Literary Festival.
I knew I recognized you.
I'm here to shamelessly promote that. It's on September 28th, and I'd be happy to answer questions about that later. So September 28th of this year. But I couldn't help but mention it because you're both recipients, and we were so honored to have both of you involved, and it was thrilling, and we had lots of people come and enjoy it.
Thank you.
Can I just do an addendum to that? You both made a sort of supersonic leap in recent years. I feel like 6 years ago, my introduction could have been exactly the same. You're insanely decorated, you're popular, everybody. And yet, something about the Overstory and Demon Copperhead both sort of had some kind of exit velocity, I feel, that even blew you out to an even bigger audience and even more acclaim. And I wonder if that's, you know, have there been things that come along with that that have been good and bad? Or
should we tell them this, the secret of happiness?
We agree. The secret of happiness is low expectations.
And keeping those low when they're exceeded, right? Not allowing yourself to habituate or attenuate to the higher rewards, you know, just find the dopamine in the cocoon, you know, in the cocoon you've brought home.
I have the life that it's the life that I want. It's, you know, I have the perfect job. I love my work. I have the perfect family. I live in an old farmhouse. I have, you know, sheep in a garden. I have the same things I had 20 years ago. And I didn't really want more then. And I'm happy.
It's actually back to the appetite question again.
Yeah.
Right? You cure appetite by attending.
By loving what you've got instead of thinking about what you don't have. And so, you know, I've always said I don't write for prizes. I write for readers. That's just, readers are my touchstone. And I grew up among people who were not really highly educated. So I've always had a commitment to accessibility, and I've never wanted to be one of those writers who's hard to read, which is a kind of, you know, writing that is rewarded by certain sorts of, there's a kind of approval that goes with that. Mm-hmm. I just never wanted it. I will say, okay, Demon has brought home a whole lot of bacon. That's the one difference. When a book stays on the bestseller list for 65 weeks, those royalty checks are huge. So I don't need that. I don't want to change the way I live. So I have just, we're working on creating some new rehab and recovery residences in Lee County, Virginia, and that's what Demon's building.
That's great. Let's start another 2 minutes, and I'm gonna start looking over here. Go ahead. How you work with scientists when you're researching, or if you do, and what was the name? I'm sorry.
Suzanne Simard, yeah.
Your relationship.
Who I worked with strictly through her research papers, actually. Yeah. People were setting up to arrange events that we would, you know, have done together after the publication of her book, Finding the Mother Tree. Then the pandemic hit. But I think the research is part of that daily pleasure of waking up and knowing that, you know, you're on to something, and, you know, it's like the greatest kind of mystery novel. You're just acquiring clues and, you know, following leads and refining crude hypotheses that you started out with at the beginning. And there's just endless pleasure in that. And the bibliography grows bigger. Your concept becomes a little less crude. There's still, you know, endless gaps that you would need to fill in to become a real expert. I mean, we're not, but, you know, the beauty of the profession is that for a few years, you can get a little vicarious taste of the road not taken, and you can do it through the people who are really in the trenches and putting out that work and doing the best you can to look at their work and understand it.
Yeah, all that, I agree. And a really important part of this for me, I mean, I'll do the research as best I can, and then a very important step in the process is to have an expert vet the novel. And with every novel, it's a different set of people, you know, but you find experts in this field and you ask them to read and say, give it to me now. I don't want to hear it later. You know, please tell me everything that I've done wrong here. And, you know, and that's a great help. So you can fix the mistakes before it goes out into the world.
And also often several experts.
I mean, different ones for different,
right.
different fields.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, you probably needed half a dozen or more for, and you needed your substance abuse experts and your football experts.
The foster care experts and all of them. Well, you work with them as you go. And I won't ask people to read the whole novel. I'll just say, can you read this football passage or can you? And that gives you some confidence, a little bit of a safety net before you send it to your publisher.
So the question is, how do we create effective, ongoing ecological and environmental protests? And I have to honestly say, for as much as the Overstory was concerned with those subjects, I wish I had done a better job at it. I mean, I was proud of writing a book where the anger and the fear and the need to say no, enough, were taken seriously, because oftentimes when literature treated protests in the past, they were held up as figures of ridicule or not to be taken entirely seriously or to be humbled in some way. And I was glad that I didn't remove my sympathy from the people who were doing those things. But I also think that my vision of effective protest matured more after the book was written, with a lot of people, you know, making clear to me in a lot of different ways that the process is slow, it's social, it's large, it's systematic, it has to be organized, you know, and all those, you know, less sexy things than chaining yourself to a tree, you know.
Yeah, I agree. And you use the tools you have. I mean, our tools are, you know, our novels. If you wherever you have expertise, if you are a child care worker, get those kids outside. Start at the beginning. If you're a parent, get your kids outside. If you are wherever you fit in the world, this process we've been talking about, this process of finding the grace to acknowledge our place in the universe is dependent on many other species. There's a way you can find to plug into that that process of finding that grace, whether it's just talking with your neighbors or writing something for your local newspaper or talking with your family or doing something in your work. It is about addressing this distance between our appetites and the appetites the world can sustain, about learning to love what we have rather than just want and buy more. It happens in a million ways because there are a million people with so many skills. The fundamental tool we have is hope. And that, I think, is a duty. That's our job. No choice. You don't get to give it up. Because when you do, you are abdicating responsibility for that world that the kids are going to have to live in. You get up and you put that on with your shoes and you keep trying. You keep engaging with a better future in whatever way you know how. And it probably won't be chaining yourself to a tree. But it'll be something.
Yeah. Something else just occurred to me, which is, why do people turn away from protests or ridicule them or shut them out? And I think it's often because people don't like to be told that they're wrong or doing bad things. They don't like to be lectured to or preached to. They don't like righteousness. And I think the most effective protests know something that one of my characters says in Overstory, which is all the arguments in the world won't change a person's mind. The only thing that'll do that is a good story. So the secret of successful protest is actually to learn psychology, to learn how to look at the person who hasn't understood that story yet, understand them sufficiently to know what kind of stories can make this personal and real to them, right? And to me, that's a non-confrontational kind of thing. That's a constant seduction.
The world changes only through conversation between the antagonistic sides. And boy, do we have the antagonistic sides in our country and our world right now. There's a problem with thinking that if those people on the other side only knew all the facts I know, they would agree with me, okay? It's so tempting to think that. No, they wouldn't. They wouldn't. They're living in a different place with different concerns and different, you know, different hopes and fears. So you can't converse with some, okay, people take information from sources they trust, period. No way around that. The radio station they trust, the people they trust, the pastor they trust, whatever. Okay, there is no way around that. So if you start a conversation with, you idiot, listen to me, over, done. So cultivating respect for the position of someone that of your, you know, your putative opponent, like why are people, you know, logging old growth forests in the Pacific Northwest? Because that's the opportunity they have, and if they and it's dangerous work, and if there were a better job available, they would take it. Okay, so where does that come from? What do we have in common? Where is our common ground? That's how conversation happens.
And often through narrative, you find through a story narrative that resembles sufficiently. I mean, if I were to sell that kind of ridiculed, radicalized, save the spotted owl, Pacific Northwest environmentalism to someone in our neck of the woods in Appalachia, it would have to be through a story that said, remember what Appalachia looked like once, right?
Sincere apologies to others who had their hands raised. We have a hard out at 7:30. I think Dizzy Gillespie might have the room next based on the seating arrangement. But please, this was obviously a huge honor and thrill for me. So please join me in thanking Barbara and Richard for being here.
Thank you.